Jenny Brocky. This week we're in Indonesia, a country of around 255 million people. Usually we hear from its politicians, but what do the rest of the people here think about their leaders, where their country's heading, and recent tensions with Australia?
Indonesia!
Welcome, everybody, to Insight, and thank you so much for having us here at Metro TV in Jakarta. I'd like to start quite broadly. There's been quite a lot of tension recently between Australian and Indonesian politicians. How do you think the two countries are getting along? Who'd like to start? Hakiki?
The most current issue because of the narcotics, the death penalty. Mm-hmm. I think in the next few months, maybe those tensions will go away. And I hope it will go because I personally hope that we still have a good relationship in between Indonesia and Australia. So that's what I hope for in the future.
What do you think of when you think of Australia? You've spent half your life there, yeah?
Yeah, I had my childhood there. So basically I have good memories of Australia. And maybe and next month I'm going back to Australia to continue my masters. So I have many expectations of Australia there. So, of course, there are worries for me when I go to Australia because of the current issues between Australia and Indonesia. Mm.
Okay, this is your chance to talk to Australians tonight. What are the kind of things you want them to understand about Indonesia? Natalia?
So, I think so far from people to people relationship, it's okay. But then, in some part, Australians fail to understand about Indonesians or, in general, Asians' culture. For example, the way of speaking or to express something in Asia, in general, we cannot speak directly or straightforward about something. But for Australians, it's something you have to express straightforward. That's a different perspective. So Australians also only understand Indonesia as Bali, maybe. But you have to understand that Indonesia is not only Bali, but more than 17,000. Yeah, more than 17,000 islands. We have more than 700 languages besides our national language, Bahasa Indonesia.
Mm. And do you think you understand us?
Indonesia, most of us, we understand Australian. That's what we thought.
You're all smiling about that idea.
So we try to be nice to Australian. And we also, there is like, we think that Australians, they are very good for us, helping us with education and so on. But the way maybe Australians see Indonesia is in different way. We are backward countries or developing countries.
Okay, what else would you like Australia to understand better about Indonesia? Yes.
I believe Australia have a genuine heart for Indonesia. This is just a politics between Indonesian politicians and Australia, of course. It's not about what the country is between Australia or Indonesia. It's about how the politicians use that issue and become nationalism issue. This is not...
On both sides?
Both sides. Mm. We have to agree with that, yeah? Politician is always politician. They gain the benefit from the issues. They gain everything from their own.
Diana, I think you were nodding to some of that. What were you agreeing with?
A lot of times, I think I've met a lot of Australians along my work, during my work, and all of the other things. And I think there's still a lot of assumptions that, oh, you know, you Indonesians agree on with death penalty, for example, or Indonesians, you guys have a lot of Muslims. That means, you know, you guys must all be extremists, for example. But
so seeing you as a big block,
yes,
with one point
exactly
of view about things.
But just as Australians are unique, consists of unique individuals, so do Indonesians. And, you know, we may disagree and we have our own opinions, but that's not represented by the government, for example.
So. Mm. Okay, anyone else like to say something on this? Adi, what about you?
The way I see it, Indonesian and Australian is actually like a marriage, you know. One day you had a bad day, And then when you had a dinner, you had your argument, but at night, both of you came to the same room and then sleep together. So, so Indonesia cannot pick its neighbor.
But is the marriage strong? That's the question.
Yeah, so this is not about, I like that gentleman opinion. This is not about the nation, not about the people. All these trips is just about a politician. I used to have an office also in Mascot in Sydney. So business to business is no problem. But I'm quite upset when I learn and then follow the news regarding the current prime minister, which is Mr. Tony Abbott. So the way
why is that? Why are you upset about him?
He's quite arrogant, in my personal opinion.
In my what way?
Number one is when he handles the taping issues with the our former president.
With SBY. Yeah,
President SBY, and then...
So this is the phone tapping where SBY's wife's phone was tapped as well.
Yeah, and then I also upset when he made that statement about the tsunami.
About the aid?
Yeah, the aid of tsunami.
And that was around the time of the Chan and Sukumaran cases.
Yeah. And then also, the last one, if we follow the news for the last 1 or 2 weeks about the refugees being
paid. The smugglers being paid to... Which is being speculated upon,
But in my opinion, in my personal opinion, it has never happened before. I mean... before his administration, but why it's happening.
But we've had disagreements before. We had disagreements about East Timor, for example.
Yes.
Big disagreement about that. You think this is different?
This is because at that time is our nation just being 32 years under the military. We just learned about democracy and all that.
Albertus, what did you want to say?
Well, I am fortunate enough to be able to spend my 7 years of education in Australia. I'm very grateful for that. And I live mostly with Australians. So as much as Australia need to learn about Indonesian, we Indonesians need to learn more about how the Australians act and why they're acting that way. So in terms of people-to-people relationship.
Okay, anyone else like to comment on this or anything else about Australia? Zahara, what do you think?
I think people-to-people contact between two nations, Australia and Indonesia, is really good. But the thing is about G2G, or government to government. I think we are neighbor, but we are like unique neighbor. The thing is about government to government, sometimes we have conflict. For example, in 2013, we have spying issues, and last year about...
So the spying issue is a big thing for a few of you. Yeah, how many of you think that's a big issue with Australia? Yeah? So, no, you don't, Matthias.
We did the same thing.
Yeah, okay, I'll let Zahara finish and then I'll come to you. Yeah,
yeah.
Keep going.
Spying issue, like, the big issue between us. And last year also the big issue when Tony Abbott said about Australian aid when Indonesia had earthquake, tsunami in 2004 in Asia. And, Tony Abbott's statement is really painful for Indonesia. That's why Indonesia collect the coin to pay back for Australian aid. And I think it's like unpolite action of Tony Abbott as a prime minister.
What do you think our government thinks about Indonesia? Yes.
The government, the ruling party in particular, they don't care about for the sake of people, let's say like that, but how to maintain their political power. I mean, Muran and Chan, at the early stage of legal process, and then suddenly, this administration tried to become a hero defending their citizen. It's only for the sake of their political power.
Zahara, do you think that? That they should have been executed, that it was the right thing for Indonesia.
Yeah, I think so. Indonesia has own law, and I think Australians have to respect Indonesian law.
Ayu, what do you think?
to execute the Bali Nine is not the right thing to do, because drugs is a never-ending circle. You kill one of the drug dealers, there are hundreds more of them.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Kiki, what do you think?
It's the right thing to do because Indonesia has the law about drugs, and Australia has the law about drugs, so that we have to respect each other.
Mm-hmm. Adi? Yes, what do you think?
My friend has a brother who died because of overdoses or because of narcotics. So I expect the foreigner who come to Indonesia to respect our law too. Mm-hmm. That this is a wrong thing to do.
Can you understand why Australians were upset about it? Yes, down the front here.
I think I do understand why Australians were enraged about the death penalty brought upon Chan and Sukumaran. It is very natural. We Indonesian also were enraged when our citizens are sentenced to death in other countries. But then again, as the gentleman said, we have our own laws, so the Australian must respect it.
Do you think Indonesia is consistent, though? Do you think it applies the same rules around the death penalty to its own citizens as it does to those Australians? Matthias.
Yeah, first, address the issues about drugs. I would like to actually inform that I was addicted with drug for 14 years.
You were addicted?
I were addicted with drug, and I also sell drugs. And then...
You used to sell drugs. You don't sell them now.
I'm a drug dealer, yeah. And now
just checking. Yes.
And it is a very big problem. As the Jokowi said, we have every day 40 people die because of drugs. But then we have to underline 200 people every day die because of smoking. Why there is no smoking fabric, cigarette fabric has been closed? Why no cigarette sellers have been arrested? Because it gives incomes.
But what do you think about the application of the law?
Everyone knows in Indonesia the judge can be paid. Everyone knows we have the corrupt prosecutors. Everyone knows we have the corrupt police. I have to pay the police, and I have to pay to make sure to pay prosecutor to reduce the sentence and then pay again to the judge. So this is very serious problems, you know?
Okay, do people agree with that? Yes.
Saya setuju dengan abang ini bahwa di Indonesia itu emang sudah jelas ya, hukum itu bisa dibeli. Sementara yang korupsi diponis aja lama gitu, diponis untuk hukumannya lama, ternyata kalau yang orang nyuri sendal atau nyuri ayam aja, sehari ketangkap langsung diponis di penjara berapa tahun, ya gitu. Saya setuju dengan abang ini bahwa saya sebagai orang bawah, hukum di Indonesia emang sudah dibeli, sudah rumit.
Okay, who else agrees with that or disagrees with that, that law in Indonesia can be bought? Yes, down here.
I partially disagree. I'm agree on that the law system is corrupt. But apart from that, I think we must not be so pessimistic about the law system itself. And I think the government has done the right thing about the execution on Chan and Sukumaran. And I want to add something on my previous comment, and I want to say sorry about the death on Chan and Sukumaran to their families. Death is a grave event, so that's all, I think.
Mm-hmm. Matthias, you knew Andrew Chan and Mayuran Sukumaran. Were you in jail with them at the same time?
With them for 2 years.
And what did you think when they were executed?
Well, this is actually, it's a really big thing, you know. It's not about Andrew Chan or Sukumaran. The death penalty is taking away the rights of people to repent themselves. Andrew and Mayu really walked the talk. They really changed themselves. And the other good thing is, they help other people like me to get rid of my addiction. So I was addicted for 14 years.
What were you addicted to?
Heroin. So, and then when I met Chan, and then realized that these guys already reformed themselves, and now they serve and help other people to transform, to have a new life.
Okay, should it make a difference if someone has been rehabilitated to whether they get executed or not? Yeah, Andy, what do you think?
Well, it should matter to our president. It was in his hands, the lives of the 64 people on death row. He has the constitutional prerogative to give them amnesty, but he decided not to. And I think that was, in my opinion, was a very bad decision, because he made that decision even before the application for clemency reached his table. And I think the majority of the public rallied behind him when he decided to execute. In my opinion, that these people had reformed and had rediscovered God, I think they should have been given a chance.
Is it hard to get a job?
A lot of the new graduates, they'd rather have nicer name cards that says fancier office addresses.
Oh, you've got your 20-somethings. Everybody wants to be the next Steve Jobs.
You live here in Jakarta. You have a young family. What sort of things are you finding difficult at the moment?
The difficulties that we face right now is everything become expensive, especially since the Jokowi administration and he pulled out the fuel subsidy. So since then, everything becomes expensive.
So since the fuel subsidy was abolished, yes, and the price of fuel went up?
Yes.
Yeah.
So everything becomes expensive. So before the Jokowi administration's, 1 gallon of bottled water is around 10 to 12,000 rupiah, but now it's 15,000 rupiah. And we consume a lot of it every day at home. So we have to make an adjustment by buying the refill one.
Are prices increasing faster than they used to?
Yes.
Yes.
It also apply to the electricity, to the gas for the stove, and everything, the groceries, of course, like, for example, meat and rice. So again, we have to make some adjustment by buying the second best quality with a more reasonable prices.
Are other people feeling this?
Yes.
Johan, yes.
It is under this administration that the inflation is too much for us. Before that, the government will immediately to rescue our currency, to normalize. And before, I think during the SBY administration, $1 only 9,000 rupees. Now we have more than 13,000 rupees for $1. So, actually, it is disappointing for us, because the action is not like the government doesn't run, but they just walk slowly. So we want them to go faster, to rescue our situation, so improve our life. So, I mean,
he hasn't been in power for very long. He's only been in power since October.
Yeah.
But you expect him to be moving faster.
Yes, it is. Yeah, we do. Because you know, the life is harder and harder for our, especially for those in our lower income.
Pandy, you're a farmer. How are you being affected by all of this?
Kalau yang saya pikir lebih sulit karena emang satu peran pemerintah sudah tidak berini lagi kepada petani. Sudah kayak enggak memperhatikan petani ya. Petani yang benar-benar petani itu pertama pendidikan kurang, itu mereka kurang mengakses bantuan-bantuan dari pemerintah.
Sutriani, you're a college graduate. What did you study?
Saya adalah lulusan dari Universitas Taman Siswa Yogyakarta, jurusan pendidikan fisika.
So what do you do to make money?
Saat ini pekerjaan saya adalah jualan jamu keliling.
So this is herbal medicine that you sell in your village?
Yes. Yes.
Why do you think you can't get a job in the area that you want to as a physics graduate?
Saya tidak bisa mendapatkan pekerjaan itu karena bukan saya yang tidak berusaha, tapi karena saya merasa tidak ada link, maksudnya tidak ada yang membawa saya untuk bisa masuk ke sebuah instansi pemerintah untuk menjadi guru, seperti itu. Jadi saya hanya bisa jadi penjual jamu seperti ibu saya.
So are connections important to getting a job? Because your mother borrowed money to get you an education, yeah?
Menurut saya, jaringan pekerjaan itu sangat penting. Soalnya bermodalkan dengan ijazah yang ber-IPK tinggi pun saat ini tidak menjamin mendapatkan pekerjaan di suatu instansi.
What do other people think about that? Yep.
It seems like the government seems like they don't really care. I mean, like, you know, they ask like young people to like go to school as possible as you can. Like, you get a good grade, look good education, like higher education. But then after that, seems like to finding a job is very like hard. You know.
Diane, you've started a business. You have a coffee shop in a market. How's it going? How do you think business is going?
For the past few months, from the beginning of the year, we feel like domestic buying power has gone down. So a lot of people, we've been trying to figure out, you know, what's going on, but probably it has something to do with the increase in the fuel price and as well as the weakening of the rupiah against the dollar.
So people aren't spending as much money.
Yeah, people aren't spending as much money. So that's one that's obviously affecting business. And I would like to respond on you know, the comments earlier about job opportunities, because from the other perspective, as business owners, especially small business owners, we find it difficult to find people who would like to work for us, because a lot of the new graduates have certain expectations, I suppose. They wanted to work in like big companies, right? You know, I even have like a friend of mine who started his own business and in the IT industry. But he decided to move an office to a bigger office building because he said he finds it difficult to find young programmers to work in a small office. They don't want it because it's not fancy enough. They'd rather have nicer name cards that says fancier office addresses than working in maybe a smaller office, but maybe the money can be used to give them better salaries. Mm. And so that's one of it.
Adi, have you had that experience? You run a software company. Does that ring true to you or not?
Yes, it is. So it's hard for me now to... Actually, I'm opening many positions in my company, actually. And it's hard to find young programmers now. Mostly, they...
Why is it hard to find them? Because they don't have the skills or because they want to work somewhere else?
Number one, they even didn't pass our psychological test. So they...
Why do they fail the psychological test?
It seems like what... She's saying they think like they are working in Silicon Valley, and second is actually English. We as Indonesian we need to improve our English ability, because when you're doing the programming, sometimes you do the not sometimes every week you're doing the conference call with your client and all that. So many of them, you know, couldn't deliver or say what they're supposed to say, something like that.
I'm interested in this because it's a young country, Indonesia, and a huge proportion of your population is under 25 years old. Do you think that the young people in this country are studying the right things, are getting the right skills for the future? I'm interested in what you think about this, Charan, because you run a big digital marketing company here and also in Singapore. What do you think about Indonesia?
I think there is definitely a gap. What we've been talking about is that millennial generation, that's fine. You know, you've got your 20-somethings. Everybody wants to be the next Steve Jobs or whatever you are. I think fundamentally the way the education system is structured is also not creating the right skills that the new economy... I mean, just look around us. The amount of penetration we've got with mobile and, you know, everyone's on social applications and mobile applications. But do we have the actual people that can make the new software to come out that people around the world will want to use? I don't think so. I think that's not going to happen. And part of it is because we're not getting the right expertise in. You know, in some circumstances, it's so hard to get talent into Indonesia. And you're not going to build local talent. The government's not letting people come in. You know, they're putting up all of these restrictions. And it's partly because the public is complaining there aren't enough jobs for the new graduates. And I agree. But The new graduates are never going to get jobs until we can get in people who are going to come in here and help build the businesses and then hire young people so that they can learn as well. Because you're not going to learn unless you bring it.
And yet you see big opportunities here.
I think there are opportunities, but unfortunately, the opportunities are going to be to service the local market. I see that the work that comes out of here is not good enough for my global clients. It's good enough for my local clients, but not good enough for my global clients.
How many of you voted for President Joko Widodo, or Jokowi, as he's known, in the last election? Can I have a show of hands on how many people voted for him? Yes, so quite a few of you. We got the impression in Australia, particularly from the Chan and Sukumaran cases, that he can be very tough. Is he a tough president?
I voted for Jokowi, but now I am very disappointed with him.
Why?
Before the president elections, I see him as a person. Leader came from the people. And I expected too much that he will bring a breakthrough to Indonesia.
What sort of a breakthrough?
Everything, in every aspect, economic, political, law and everything, education. For example.
What did you want him to change, though?
Everything. Everything.
Do you think you might have expected too much?
Yes, yeah. I was expecting too much. But then, when he was elected to be the president of Indonesia, there was a rumor that he is the puppet of his party, the PDIP party. I wasn't believe at the moment.
You didn't believe that?
Before. I wasn't believe before, but now I think he is.
But in what way? About what sorts of things?
He cannot be... apa tegas tuh ya? Tegas. Firm.
He can't
be firm with his own words. And...
What, so he doesn't stick to what he says he's going
yes,
to do?
Yes. Yes, and today he said this, and tomorrow he said different, and then most of the policies, I think he's not the one who make it, but the
You think
party,
the policies are
yes,
coming from
driven
the party,
by the
but
party,
not from him?
Driven by the party.
Okay, what do others think? Pandi, what do you think? Because you campaigned for Jokowi, didn't you, in the election. How do you think he's going?
Yeah. Yeah, sir. Saya petani, saya termasuk keluarga besar yang mendukung Jokowi. Kebetulan saya mendirikan Seknas Tani Jokowi ya. Dulu pernah saya jadi ini. Dan saya juga dengar janji Jokowi buat petani. Bagikan tanah untuk petani. Kalau saya menang, saya akan bagikan tanah untuk petani. Karena gitu kan. Saya makanya sekarang menyampaikan aspirasi bahwa mana janji Jokowi untuk membagikan tanah untuk petani? Kalau mau pengen pangan murah, daging murah, bagikan tanah untuk petani.
That was obviously very popular comment that you made there. Fadil, you volunteered for the campaign as well, yeah? What do you think now?
I'm still support Jokowi, and I think my people. Because I'm head of volunteer from village country, Fleger, I think they still support Jokowi because what he made is bright to the future. This is the foundation to the future for Indonesian people.
Natalia, you put your hand up that you'd voted for Jokowi. Do you still support him?
I voted for Jokowi. And then now I see that Jokowi, if I can say, Jokowi have to see clearly that he is the president of the country. It's not the president of a party or a group of parties.
What are the good things he's done since he's been in office? He's only been in office for what, since October, yeah? Yeah, Deanne.
I had my own disappointments too, but to be fair, he did come up with some ideas and new concepts.
What
like
concepts?
Like improving old system that has existed before, like for Kartu Indonesia Pintar the Indonesian Smart Indonesian card and then the health cards.
And what do they do?
Yeah, a smart card to also be able to reach kids who are not in school, who are outside the system, kids who are dropouts.
To give them a free education?
To give them a free education and give so they can also have access to this fund.
And the health card?
The health card is also the same. It's also reaching out to a bigger audience. However, so this is a great concept. He's like basically adding up to whatever is already existing, making it more whole. The problem is, that's where it stops. There's no, it didn't, it was not followed through by a clear mechanism on how it's supposed to work. A lot of his initiatives are that way, so it stops at a certain level, not followed through.
Haryanto, you've benefited from President Jokowi. Let's have a look.
Nama saya Haryanto, usia saya 54 tahun. Saya asli Jawa Timur, datang ke Jakarta 1900 tahun 78. Ya, saya datang ke Jakarta ingin mencari kerja. Ya, saya kerja serabutan, ya bak mobil, ya cleaning service, ya di bangunan, apalah nyervis elektronik, bikin sumur jet pump. Hampir semua kerjaan saya jalanin. Iya, saya pas operasi waktu itu dan biayanya ini nggak sedikit, sangat besar. Biaya 461 juta itu saya nggak mesti keluar biaya, ditolong sama pemerintah. Ya tiap hari saya mesti ya dengan kerjaan apalah selalu bawa sepeda pada jarak jauh, mungkin lagi bisa dilihat kemana. Dan itu saya alami tiap hari, Tuhan masih menjaga Pak Haryanto, masih dijaga benar-benar dari hal apa.
Haryanto, President Jokowi intervened in your case when he was governor of Jakarta to pay that bill. Why did he do that?
Saya nggak merasa bayar ya. Waktu itu saya sakit, kepake KJS itu dari rujukan puskesmas langsung ke RSCM. Terus di dokter mengatakan harus dioperasi kena penyakit gula. Ya saya nyerah aja. Saya kan rakyat jelata. Untuk hari-hari aja nggak ketemu, apalagi untuk berobatnya segitu. Semuanya pertolongan Tuhan tepat waktu melalui Jokowi masih jadi gubernur dulu.
What would have happened if you hadn't had that assistance?
Ya mungkin aja saya ketolong ya nggak berada di sini, nggak tahu nasib selanjutnya. Karena itu saya bersyukur.
He was a very popular governor. Do you think he can be a very popular president?
Ya mudah-mudahan bisa lah ke depannya.
Chika, you voted for Jokowi. What do you think now?
Well, I have to be really critical to him in terms of fulfillment of human rights issues. First things about abolish death penalty because it's important. And the other thing, they are not giving any adequate attention to discriminatory laws that happens in Indonesia, discriminatory bylaws during the presidential campaign. He explained that he promised us to fulfill the women's rights and children's rights law for better Indonesia, and we trust that, and we trust him, and we also give a big hope for him.
Would you vote for him now?
Well, maybe yes, maybe not, but
oh, that's,
it's been
come
done.
On. You're not sure?
I'm not sure.
Yeah, okay. Tony, what about you? What do you think about the way the president has performed so far?
To be fair, firstly, that we must remember that he's not been in reign for a year. It is not fair to judge whether his performance is good or bad, but he needs to realize that he has the power to do so what he wants.
Does he have the power?
Yes, he does. He does have the power. The Constitution says that But I think most of us feel that he's controlled by his party. But I think it is unfair if we say that his performance is bad for now. And I will still vote for him.
Okay, so you still want to give him time.
Yes.
Yeah. Sahara, you didn't vote for Jokowi. Why?
Yeah, that's true. Because I think there is someone who has powerful behind Jokowi. And maybe Australian...
Who has the power behind Jokowi?
And maybe Australian doesn't know who is behind Jokowi and sees Megawati. Megawati has
Megawati
power.
Megawati Sukarnoputri.
Yeah. Megawati Sukarnoputri has power to support Jokowi. So
and she is the former president.
Yes,
for the
previous presidents before Jokowi. Yeah.
What is it about when you say there are other people pulling the strings? Yes, Abotis.
The pulling the strings part is because the old politician want to keep it the old way. Whilst what we have now is a government, is a president at least, the one person that want to change the whole thing for the country, for the better of the country. Example, one thing is he want to transform this country from consumption to production country. So he cut the food subsidy to put into the health, education, and infrastructure.
Okay.
So in terms of that, I think this man is fighting the old politician, wants to get it the old way, and that's therefore we the people have to support him, and I do support him until now.
Andy, is the president a strong leader, in your opinion?
I think Jokowi is the weakest president Indonesia has had because he does not chair a political party. The other
He's
president,
not the chair of the party.
He does not control any political party. The other presidents before him, they all were chair of their respective parties. That became their political base when they govern in a coalition government. I think the problem now is that he cannot control the coalition, and I think this has to do a lot with his leadership qualities.
Where are they winning and he's losing?
Well, I think it's mostly about the appointments of key positions in the government. The cabinet, for example, I don't think it was filled mostly by his people of his choice. And I think this is also reflected, even to the point that the president just last week threatened to replace some of the ministers because they failed to deliver. But I think behind that message is that because some of them did not deliver precisely because they were not working for him, but they were working for their political parties.
And what about corruption? He campaigned very strongly against corruption. Is he delivering on that?
Well, again, that's one area that he seems to be failing because, there was the one issue was the appointment of the national police chief. Again, he lost that battle against Megawati. Megawati wanted her choice of a national police chief, and Jokowi did not want. But eventually, there was a compromise, so neither get that position. But it's the compromise, I think, affects the entire quality of the anti-corruption campaign.
Okay, and so that's why you think he's not a strong leader, is because he's not getting his own way around the things he wants to do about corruption.
Yes, because he has to negotiate with his coalition partners. And they, I think, get in the way of his many of his programs because they want to be part of the president. They want to have a share of the power. And this, I think, deprived Jokowi of the full power that he should have as the elected president.
How many people think corruption is a problem in Indonesia? Hands up. Okay, a lot of you. A lot of you putting your hands up. Fadil, where do you think it's a problem?
I think corruption is the main problem for Indonesian people. Because corruption make a poor people become really, really, really poor. And that's make a really, really damage for Indonesian people.
So where is there corruption, do you think, in this country?
Government and court and other real many sectors.
Okay, I want to ask just about how corruption works. Like, how do you see it day to day? Are you? What sort of things?
I think the corruption is in every stage of bureaucracy. For example, my helper at home, my assistant, she has to pay 250,000 rupiah for making an ID card. when it's supposed to be free for every citizen of Indonesia.
Fadil, can you give me an example just of something where you think corruption is operating?
Because I'm working from a lawyer, I have an example that we need to pay the judge to win the court. So I see, I can say what I see, but I see the people pay the judge to win the court.
Win the court case?
Yeah, yes.
How much money?
500,000.
It depends on the case. How much did you pay, Matthias?
It depends on the case. I mean, they knew that the drug dealers have much money, so they will add more money for the drug dealers.
How much did you pay?
It's when about you mentioned earlier 200 million that was in
200 million rupiah.
Yeah.
So how do you think corruption can best be addressed? I mean, you have an anti-corruption body here, the KPK. Is it not working? Are you?
Yeah. Yeah, the KPK commissions, I think it's only for big corruptions, but for little corruptions for the ID card, for the police way, no, it doesn't work.
Okay, how do you change it?
It feels like corruption is in our DNA. We have to change our mindset, morality, mentality, and it's also the part of the government's job, which is giving a good education, giving a good mental mindset, and to reform our mindset.
Indonesian government thinks like right now Australia is a very beautiful and a sexy wife, but a bit of naughty right now.
We're back to the wife again.
Yeah.
To wrap up fairly soon, but I want to ask you what sort of neighbour you think Australia is. Natalia, do you want to answer that?
Australian behaviour regarding border protection policy has actually caused difficulties in Indonesia as its neighbour, because when Australia's policy cut the number of acceptance refugee to Australia, for example, and also stop accepting a refugee register in Indonesia since July last year. It means Indonesia as a transit country have to deal with asylum seekers and refugee here. It's another social problem for Indonesia.
Okay, government. So what do the rest of you think of the way that Australia deals with this issue?
As a lucky country, as a rich country, Australia must also help others, you know. Don't think of yourself. We live in the world like this, and we have to help unlucky people like Rohingya. They are persecuted in their country, so they flee, and they need help. Yeah, and they should assist them. And
so how do you feel about the way the Australian government deals with it then? Do you think
it's a bit arrogant.
Australia,
but I don't care. Yeah, because okay, Indonesia, you do it yourself. I don't care about that. I just close my door. This is your problem. So it should not be that way. Australia should assist us in this case.
And what about paying people smugglers? The idea of paying people smugglers to turn those boats around, to send those people back. What do you think about that? Yes.
If the Australian government really paying that smugglers. Actually, this is not good for Australian itself, because it can become a business opportunity for Indonesian. We just keep sending people and then we got the money from Australia.
And what about the way that the Indonesian government deals with people smugglers?
I get this feeling that Indonesian government thinks like right now Australia is a very beautiful and sexy wife, but a bit of naughty right now.
We're back to the wife again.
Yeah. So that's why, you know.
A naughty wife.
Yeah, so this is a very easy things to solve, actually. Just open the communication and then try to understand.
Karim, can I get a very quick comment from you on this? Because you're a refugee, you're originally from Afghanistan, you live in Indonesia. now, and you've tried to get to Australia four times. What do you think of the way both governments deal with this issue?
I think I tried four times actually to get to Australia by boat, but each time the authorities, Indonesian authorities, I mean, they turn us back.
They stopped you before you got to Australian waters,
to go to Australia waters. And I don't know about Australia, actually, but I think Indonesian government at the moment, they are treating us well as a refugee. Like they, here, they treat us like as a human. Before, in my own country, I'm from Afghanistan, but grew up in Pakistan. So there in Pakistan, there is war, and they are targeting Hazara people specifically. So here in Jakarta or in Bogor, where refugees live, but we live in Cisarua, and we don't think when we are walking about the bullet to break our head. So I think, I'm not saying about the deal, but I only say about they are treating us well.
Okay. I want to just talk about extremism for a moment. The Australian government is very focused on extremism and the issues that are arising about young people going to fight in Iraq and in Syria. Are you concerned about those things here in Indonesia? Nodding your head, Natalia, yes?
It's a global issue. All of us should be aware about it. And indeed, Indonesian government is now also hand in hand with other countries try to prevent people from joining extremist group, or let's say ISIS.
Is it something that Indonesians fear that people will do here?
Yes, that's real fear.
Is it something of concern to you, people being radicalized, ISIS being attractive to people? No, Matthias, you don't think so.
You know, it is an issue, but then we don't have to really big worry about it. Like, we have like 700 languages in Indonesia, so many different ethnic groups, but then we have what we call Pancasila, again, which is protect our freedom for the religious, on the religious issues.
Tobias, what do you think about this?
I agree with Matthias' assessment. Radicalization, of course, it's a problem. It's a problem everywhere. But I think that's not something that's mushrooming in Indonesia. And I think what Australians need to know regarding, for example, Indonesian Islam, we are actually a very different Islam than Middle East. I mean, I can't speak since I'm not a Muslim, but...
A different Islam than the Middle East?
Yes, and that's what Australians need to know as well, because we're definitely, we produce a different trajectory, both historically, but also it's important in the global discourse.
Do you think Australia understands that?
Not necessarily, no, because one interesting poll that recently came out is by Lois Institute, that even Australians think Indonesia is not a democracy. I mean, a majority doesn't think Indonesia is a democracy. Indonesia has problems, but it's a vibrant democracy. In the same way with its religion. We have, of course, various peppering of issues of radicalism, but as a whole picture, both historically, but also as a trajectory, we produce a very different way of dynamics between politics and religion compared to the Middle East.
Mm. When we asked you who you thought was a leader in the region, a number of you said Singapore. And I just wonder where you think Australia sits in the region. Do you see it as part of your region?
Australia is a different continent then. So in this sense, we understand Australia is not part of Asia. Australia is Asian neighbor, yes. So, but if Australia wants to maintain relationship with Asian, please understand about Asian also. And we try to understand Asian, Australian way. That's I think, the balancing that we can maintain for good relationship in the future, from now on and in the future.
Mm-hmm. I just wonder how well you think both your politicians and Australia's politicians represent us as people to one another.
I think ultimately all Indonesians want is that respect as a nation, that, hey, we're a democracy, where we might be finding our feet, but if Australian politicians can give necessary that amount of respect and speak to them as peers, I think this relationship can go a lot further as well.
Anyone else want to make a final comment here? Yes, off the back, Albertus.
Because I studied there for a long time, and I do, despite what the politicians say, despite what happened in the news, what the news say, I would certainly say that I and most of the people here, we love Australia as a country, as a neighbour. And we do love Australian people. and we do learn a lot. We do get a lot of from Australia. Australia, on the other hand, also get a lot from us.
Hey, Kiki, you're going back to Australia soon to study. What are you expecting?
I don't know, because until now, I love the sport. I love the sport, and I hope because of my love for sport, maybe I can get closer to Australians. Maybe I can get to know their culture, and then they can get to know me as well, and my Indonesian background. So maybe we can benefit from our hobbies.
You like the AFL, yeah?
I like the AFL. I like
Good
the Sydney
choice.
Swans. I like the Sydney Swans.
Johan, he's following in your footsteps because this is what you did. You studied in Australia. How are you feeling about him going
yes,
to
of
Australia?
Course. Yes, of course. I'm proud of him because he is following my footsteps. That he is coming to my uni I went to before. We all benefited from Australia as a neighbor. The same way Australia also benefited from because we are good neighbor basically. And I believe that both nations will live together peacefully, and yeah, we can work on it.
All right, we do have to leave it there, I'm afraid. There's a lot more we could talk about. Thank you so much for welcoming us so much to your country, and to Metro TV too for hosting us here tonight. It's been really interesting to hear your stories, and of course we can keep talking about this. Very interested in your experiences. If you might be an Indonesian Australian, for example, you might want to jump onto Twitter and Facebook and talk about what we've been discussing tonight.
Next week on Insight, saving extremely premature babies.
She's absolutely beautiful. She's the most tiniest little thing I've ever seen. She's a little fighter.
How far should doctors go?
And that is all we have time for now, but do stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everybody. Fantastic. Thank you. Well done.